Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, I need you.
Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my lips. Day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water. Your forgiveness.
Today I start a new series entitled Walking Through the Wilderness. And really it's a series that's born out of my own heart, out of where I am. Until this weekend, I had never, without someone asking me, shown anyone a picture of my grandchildren. But I love them dearly. I want to explain to you the term progressive. I'm not talking about progressive political politics. I'm talking about progressive, how things progress. When our country was founded, one of the first expenditures in our nation First Continental Congress was to appropriate funds to print the first book in America. Its purpose is that they decided that schools needed a reading primer, and that there needed to be some type of standard. And pushed by George Washington, the First Continental Congress, the first book printed in America was actually a Bible. Matter of fact, the law was passed that the Bible be used in all schools, elementary schools and up, to teach children how to read and teach them about God. I was talking to a gentleman the other day, and he wanted to talk politics and reparations and all that kind of stuff, and he explained to me how that everybody, you know, that everybody understands that Abraham Lincoln, you know, freed the slaves and all over the United States. And I said, well, it's actually not the case. He freed all the slaves south of the Mason-Dixon line. But no, he's not the first president that banned freedom. I said, yeah, he was. He abolished slavery. I said, well, no, the first president to actually do that was a guy you've probably never heard of. His name was George Washington. Matter of fact, George Washington said the greatest thing that he did in his life was write, pass the Northwest Ordinance. Matter of fact, many of you come from descendants of a type of slavery called indenture. A large percentage of people in the United States, the very beginning, came as indentured servants. If you had a debt, you sold yourself physically for 7 to 14 years. If you wanted passage to the new land, you sold yourself for 7 to 14 years, and you worked as a person doing whatever they told you to do. You didn't get paid as an indentured servant. Matter of fact, for the first several decades in the United States, there were more indentured servants than slaves by bondage. They were slaves by finances. The Northwest Ordinance banned all of that. Any area that wanted to be a new territory had to be free of slavery and free of indenture. The Northwest Ordinance also required that all states have prayer in their schools, use the Bible in their schools. Matter of fact, a great hero. Matter of fact, George Washington, when he finished the presidency, prophesied that what would happen the other day at the election would actually happen. And he said, when he left, he said, never go to a two-party system, because people, representatives, will serve their party instead of people. The other thing he said is that we needed to make sure that we understood that God was the foundation of our nation, because if we didn't do that, then we would heap upon ourselves whatever we want. Never remove the Bible, never remove prayer, never remove God, and never go to two parties. Well, guess what we did? We've gone to two parties, we've removed the Bible, we've removed prayer. Matter of fact, is it not any reasonable to understand that the first thing that was desired to do was to remove the Bible, remove prayer? Matter of fact, they removed George Washington's farewell address. Matter of fact, for the first 140 plus years of our nation's history, George Washington's farewell address was required reading in history books. Matter of fact, it's no longer in history books any longer taught in our schools. Why do you remove the standard? You remove the standard so that you can do what you do want to do. If you go, the worst problems in the 1950s in school was talking and chewing bubble gum. If you talk to anybody in the city of Dallas and Dallas County, if you look it up on the CDC website, you'll find the majority of 17-year-old girls in Dallas County have a sexually transmitted disease before they turn 18. The majority, not the minority. Go look it up. If you don't believe me, go look it up. Why? Why has Why has that permeated our society? Because we remove the standard and we continue to move. I remember when the cool thing that you did that you never talked about was smoke marijuana when I was a teenager. I didn't, okay, because I played football and actually had to work for a living, and it's hard to work for a living while you're doing that, waiting on tables and driving, and that just don't mix. Remember when it became medical marijuana and now it's open marijuana in many states. Why? Because we always move, we always progress. When there's no standard, we desire what we want, we get what we want, right? Now the state of Oregon has said, you know, it's just not marijuana. But by the way, if you're caught with crack, heroin, cocaine, or any hard drugs, it's no longer a crime. We'll make sure that we offer you free counseling. It's not best for you. You see, the truth about it is life is not about good and bad. You see, oftentimes we talk about good and bad, good and bad, good and bad. But the truth about it is, if we're going to live life that's over the top and life that's great, it's not about good and bad. It's not about doing what is good. It's not doing what's better. It's doing what is best. You see, at some point in time as a church, we're going to have to stop mamby-pambying and being all nice and kind. I remember Joel Osteen being interviewed, and yes, he preaches to thousands, and I preach to hundreds. He was asked, what do you think about the move in the LGBT community to make it okay? He says, well, you know, it's not God's best. Guys, it's not even God's radar. You can't have children like that. Things are not functional physically like that, but oh, it's okay. Now, whether you believe it was right or wrong, or if it was put in place or not, or if somebody actually really did fill out a ballot, or somebody filled out a bunch of them for somebody, we now have a president-elect that believes that kids in second grade have a right to be transsexual and that their parents have the right to give them hormones that modify their physical bodies so that when they turn 16, they can have a surgery to be physically modified. And we know that over 40% of them think about or actively contemplate taking their lives according to the LGBT community. We just keep moving and moving. So anyway, that's all I'm thinking about. I've got 4 amazing grandchildren. I was holding my little 1-month-old in my arms and dancing with her, singing to her the other day. And I thought about, she's going to go to a school where now the president-elect has promised that she's going to have to be not spoken to as a girl, but regardless of her DNA, she's whatever she decides to be. I don't want somebody talking to her about that. I know that a majority of our children growing up in Dallas County are growing up in homes where they're not taught the Bible or taught about God. They're growing up in the wilderness. If we're moving to crack and heroin and cocaine is, well, it's not good for you, but come on. You're going to do what you want to do, so it's okay. We'd rather you get counseling. You say, well, Carl, it's just one state. Well, it's always been just one state until it becomes 2 and 3 and 4 and 5. Even the Texas State Legislature, a subcommittee, is actually looking at legalizing marijuana. But Carly, marijuana is not addictive. Okay, Say, I agree with you. I don't, but it's not addictive. Can it be destructive? Yes. But we've seen in states it's a step. So the truth about it is that I realize that my grandkids are growing up in the wilderness. If they're taught about God, to be a man or a woman of God, they're going to be out there alone. Now, as a gramps or ribbit or grandpa, whatever you want to call me, I don't care as long as they call me. They can call me, hey, you. I don't care. I'll answer. My daughter lets her not quite two-year-old call me in. And when I answer the phone, it's, Amp, I'm on answer. In the middle of committee meeting, excuse me, it's my granddaughter. Give me just a minute. I know that many of you have children, you have grandchildren, some of you have great-grandchildren. So what do you do? What do you do for children growing up in the wilderness? Probably the best illustration I know of that in the Bible is a guy named John the Baptist. Matter of fact, the Bible says hundreds of years before John the Baptist would be born, that he would be like one crying in the wilderness. The wilderness is a place of being alone. The wilderness is a place that is isolated. The wilderness is a place that's uncomfortable. So how do we prepare them to grow up in a place that's uncomfortable? To be truthful with you, I believe it's all about imprinting. You see, that's why we want that there's a desire to pull the Bible out, to pull prayer about, to pull the history of God in our nation. Why is it being removed? Because we want to imprint something other than ethics and morals and what is right and wrong. John the Baptist was one such kid. In the book of Luke chapter 1, we pick up the story. I want to tell you what, God's got guts. God's got guts because in Luke chapter 1, he calls a woman old. So I just thought I'd throw that out. That was free. I mean, it's been so deep. Y'all are looking at me like you're a cat about to get run over by a diesel pickup truck. I just wanted to lighten it up, okay? Luke chapter 1, verse 13. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayers have been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will never take wine or other fermented drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring many back of the people back of Israel to the Lord their God. He will go out before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the people, parents, to their children, to the disobedient, to the wisdom of righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. You see, the truth about it is that God from the very beginning tried to help Zechariah, and Elizabeth understood that John was born with a purpose. You see, the truth about it is that people that take a stand understand that life is about purpose. You don't take a stand unless you understand you're there for that reason. Several years back, my son, Jesse, was graduating from Marine boot camp in San Diego, and all the families got together and met with the gunny. And you need to understand, some of you know my oldest son, some of you don't. My son grew up a band geek. And I don't mean just kind of like a nerd. I'm talking about a geeky, band geeky nerd, okay? I grew up playing football and lifting weights. The only weight my son ever lifted was a piccolo, up and down. I mean, by the time he went into boot camp, he played 26 different instruments. I mean, if Jesse did anything on his spare time, I was shocked the first time he said, I'll never forget, Cindy's here. He said, Dad, guess what? I asked Tracy Burr to go out on a date with me, and I was so shocked. I love Tracy to death. A wonderful woman of God. I was so excited. I said, Jesse, you've never invited a girl. He said, well, Dad, I really don't have time, but she's a nice Christian girl and we're just going to do something. Dad, don't think about it, anything. I mean, we're just going to go out and have a good time because I really want to learn how to play the French horn, and that's what I'm going to do tomorrow. So, you know. So anyway, I'm sitting down with Jesse's Gunny, and I said, "How'd it work?" He said, "How'd what work?" I said, "You know, you had Jesse." He said, "Well, there was a lot of vomit and tears the first day, and the second day it got worse." I said, "How did he make it?" He said, "You know, he just stuck to it." I said, "You know, he came in, he playing the flute and the piccolo. That's, you know, it's not what you think about Marines." He said, "Well, you need to understand, in the Marine Corps, every man's a rifleman. But my job as a gunny sergeant is to break them down, to build them back with a purpose." He said, "Marines have three purposes in life." So I said, "What's that?" He said, "Well, it's God, Corps, country." He said, why do you think that Marines will die for the guys in their platoon? Because when we put them back together after breaking them down, they have God as first priority, Corps second, country's third." The video I'm fixing to show you is in a meeting room for a group of Marines that are fixing to go on a mission. And this is how they started their meeting before they explained what it was going to be like going into harm's way. Watch this.
Thank you.
Why is it that one of the most elite fighting forces on the face of the earth understands that placing God as the priority of your life sets the standard for all morals, ethics, and decisions? Because they understand that people that stand do it because they understand their purpose. The second thing you need to understand is that purpose gives reason and hope. In Luke chapter 1, verse 39, at that time Mary got ready and hurried to the town, hill country of Judea. This is after Mary had found out she was expecting. She entered Zachariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the spirit of joy. Why is it that children leap? Because they're excited. They're filled with hope. Even before John was born, he wasn't fetal tissue. He was a child with a purpose, and he leapt for joy. Why? Because my purpose. If children are going to stand in the wilderness, they need to understand they have a purpose, because no matter what happens, it will give reason, it will give hope. I don't care what happens to a person, if you have purpose, there's always hope. Somebody asked me one time after I was cussed out for taking a stand, Carl, does that upset you? Were you going to stop? No. Why? That's why I'm here. You see, it doesn't make any difference what comes against you, what people think about you, what's going on around you, whether people like you or not, or whether people accept you or not. If you have purpose, you'll always have reason, and you will always have hope. Purpose defines actions. In John chapter 14, John the Baptist had found out that Herod, which was the ruler, the Roman authority over Israel, was having sex with his niece. Now, I realize that you're not supposed to talk about that kind of thing. I remember the first time I was pastor in Crenshaw, Mississippi, and I used the word pregnant. And the lady came to me and said, "We don't use that kind of word in church." When I preached on the problem of giving prepubescent children sex change hormones, I got an email from a guy that says, "Man, why are you talking about that in church? Where is she supposed to talk about it?" At some point in time, the church in America has got to stand up, and instead of being politically correct, instead of everybody going, "Well, you know, you just speak the truth in love." John's friend said, "John, if you confront Herod publicly, Herod can kill you." He said, "Okay." But John, you're going to embarrass him. When I clamored and demanded attention when in the city of Dallas we were suing to make sure abortion clinics were opened while you couldn't get your teeth cleaned. God told me, and I quote, he says, "See if we ever get you to pray at our opening session again." And I looked at him and said, "Well, I can live with that." John understood his purpose of that. Herod had arrested John and bound him and put him in prison because of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. John had been saying to him, "It's not lawful for you to have her." Herod wanted to kill him, but he's afraid of the people because he considered John a prophet. John did not keep his mouth shut because he understood, excuse me, he was there for a purpose at that moment in time. Purpose defines action. Purpose drives the quest for knowledge. If you'll notice in Luke chapter 1, verse 17, "And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to the children, the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous. When you understand your purpose, you have a quest for knowledge to fulfill that purpose. I want to know how to do this. I want to know how to teach. I want to know how to do this. Excuse me. Shelly, would you get me a glass of water, please? Not like you're going to give me cooties or something. Shelly's my wife, if you're a visitor, by the way. John sought out Scripture so that he could be that person God called him to be. Purpose drives behavior. Luke chapter 1, verse 15, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will never take wine or fermented drink. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even before the Lord. Thank you, Michaela. For those that are visitors, my good friend Michaela Sandifer, she's not my wife. But thank you very much, Michaela. Michaela just moved to Fort Worth with her new job and still drives from Fort Worth to be here to help us worship. Michaela, thank you. Purpose drives behavior. Remember I said a few minutes ago that life is about making decisions not between good and bad, but between good, better, and best. Okay, don't jump on me, okay? But I'm just going to tell you the truth. I don't believe drinking a glass of wine is a sin. Now, my dad believes that if you drink a glass of wine, you're going to go to hell. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. But the only problem with that is that Paul told Timothy to drink a glass of wine for his stomach. So if Paul told Timothy to do it, that means that Paul, the guy that wrote most of the New Testament, is going to hell. So I don't agree with my dad. We don't agree about some things. That's one of those things we don't agree about. But you'd say, well, Carl, what do you mean? He says, well, it says that he wasn't going to drink wine. You see, the difference is not that drinking a glass of wine is a sin. The Bible says that being drunk with wine is a sin. You're not supposed to be drunk because you don't have the ability to make cognitive decisions based on following God. The other reason between good and best is Jerry Clower was one of my heroes. I never forget sitting down listening to Jerry Clower, and he says, why do people socially drink? He said, it's kind of like playing Russian roulette. We know statistically, proven, I'm not making this stuff up, okay, guys? Okay, just go study it. If you don't believe me, Google it. You know, Google will never lie. Matter of fact, you might even find it on Twitter unless it's already been banned. But anyway, out of every seven people that takes a social drink becomes an alcoholic. And because of alcoholism, it hurts you financially. It hurts your marriage. It hurts your kids. Alcoholism destroys your life. If you don't believe me, talk to Eddie, who works in a downtown homeless shelter, and he'll tell you the effects that alcohol has on men that were married, had kids, that now are living on the streets because a social drink took them further than they ever dreamed you would take. Am I lying, Eddie? Eddie's the bald-headed guy that's nodding his head. You can see that. Okay, here we go. So anyway, Jerry Clower said, if you had a dog that bit one out of every seven people at your house, what would you do with that dog? It depends on the people. If he said this, he said, you must have heard him. Jerry Clower said, well, if I could pick which one of the seven it was going to bite. Then he goes on to say, but you know, there's this game called Russian Roulette. It's almost the same, but it's like you take a revolver, you put one shot, one bullet in six cylinders, spin it, put it to your head, and pull the trigger. Well, how many of y'all have played Russian roulette? You're an idiot if you have. If you take a six-cylinder pistol, put a shell in it, pull the hammer back and stick it to your head, wondering if the one bullet is the one that's fixing to fire, you have mental and emotional problems. We need to get you straight to a psychological counselor, okay? We don't do that. Why? Because we don't want to take the chance. It's not a difference in right and wrong. It's a difference between good, better, and best. If you want to take life to the next level, you don't do what's good. You don't do what's better, you do what's best. Purpose defines the difference, not just in good and bad, but in good, better, and best. Just the way it goes. So there's things that John's not going to do. He could do, but he doesn't. Paul said, you know, there's some things that I could do. I don't do them. Why? Because it's not best for me. I don't know about you, but my grandchildren, I don't want them to just do good instead of bad. I want them to do what's best for them for the kingdom. The difference in good, better, and best. So the question, excuse me, I don't have COVID. I have this thing called allergies. And I was outside all afternoon yesterday cooking for a friend. And as the smoke wafted through the air, it wafted in my lungs and put impents in them that I can't get rid of. So here's my question. I said, God, my grandchildren are growing up in the wilderness, and the wilderness needs some Johns. The wilderness, the place of isolation and aloneness and dryness and difficulty, needs some Johns. And I want them to be that. I married a woman with purpose. We left a good paying job to go to seminary and couldn't find a job. And I was relegated to selling peepholes door to door. And I'll never forget coming home one afternoon. It's in August. And New Orleans in August is about 99 degrees. And there's another 99 number that's worse. The humidity's 99. So you're not only breathing hot air, you're breathing hot, wet air. And I came in and it was, I mean, her hair was wet. She had sweat everywhere. She wasn't glistening. She was sweating. She was sweating and she was pregnant and sweating. Pregnant, sweating with a little kid. She's only 8 months along. She was out to here. She didn't get very, just kidding. I said, baby, air conditioner's not on. She said, no, it's not. You ready for supper before you go out and work? I said, yeah, I'm kind of ready. She says, supper's going to be cold tonight. She had fixed tuna fish for the sixth day in a row, I think. That's probably wrong. It was probably for the seventh day in a row. You could buy five cans of tuna fish on sale at Swegman's for a dollar at the time. And we had tuna fish for breakfast, tuna fish for lunch, tuna fish for supper. We had tuna fish anyway. She even made tuna fish patties. And usually at night, you know, she'd put them in patties and kind of cook them. Lunch, she'd put pecans in them that she'd picked up out, you know. Anyway, sometimes for breakfast, she'd put mandarin oranges, tuna fish everywhere. I said, so it's cold tuna fish. She said, cold tuna fish. I said, well, babe, what's going on? She said, well, the air conditioner's off. And I said, yeah, I don't understand that. Baby, it's 98 outside. It's got to be 110 in here. She said, well, I had to come in and fix supper. I said, well, what's going on? She said, well, the electricity's off. 8 months pregnant in New Orleans, 98 degrees, and she looks at me and says, the electricity's off. It is hot. She said, well, why don't we just get stuff and we'll go outside and sit down under the tree. It's cooler out there. When you go outside because it's cooler in August in New Orleans, she never complained. She never fussed. All she says, I know you're working hard. I'm in school trying to learn how to be a pastor and study. That's it. There wasn't an argument. There wasn't a complaint. When I first started dating her on the one date that we had, after I'd asked her to marry me, she went out with this guy whose dad owned a 25-story high-rise and drove a Porsche. She never said, well, I could have done that. One of her friends in school by that time was going up as to be an executive in FedEx. She never looked at me and said, well, you know, I probably should have picked Scott instead of you. Never once. She just said, well, you know, we'll get it back on. Why? Purpose drives behavior. Purpose brings about joy. Purpose defines action. Purpose drives a quest for knowledge. So how do we do that? Three ways. Number one, instill from the beginning of life the foundation of existence. Our existence is purpose. From the very beginning. Notice what it says in the book of Luke, chapter 1, verse 13 and 15. But the Lord said to him, do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son. You will call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. He will be great in the sight of the Lord. Even before John the Baptist took a breath, God said, Zechariah, John has a purpose. You see, this idea that children become humans the day they're born is a fallacy. Every child conceived has a purpose with God. There's a reason for them being. You see, our job in life, our purpose in life is not to be a welder or a technician or a computer geek or a marine or a Navy man or a trash collector or a stay-at-home mom or a secretary or a doctor or a lawyer or a dentist. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things will be added to you. You see, the great purpose of life is to seek the kingdom of God, to be focused on God, and everything else is going to fall into place. From the very beginning, we need to help them understand that they have a purpose. Isaiah 49, verse 5, and now the Lord says, He who formed me in the womb to be His servant, to bring Jacob back to Him and gather Israel to Himself, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength. Isaiah said here, God said, this is what I want you to do. Paul, that I talked about earlier, was a tent maker by trade. He provided for himself by making tents, but his purpose was to be a church planter. His vocation was simply a way to provide for himself, to provide for his ministry. Every child born has a ministry and a purpose intended by God. And we need to teach them that from the very beginning. In Genesis 1:26, then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the sky, over the livestock, the wild animals, over the creatures that move along the ground. Every human being that has ever been created, that has ever been made, that has ever been born, God said, I have a purpose for you. We need to understand that. Your purpose is not your vocation. Your purpose is that you are a beautifully and wonderfully made child of God. He loves you with a love that will not quench, that is unquenchable. He loves you so much, He took His Son, He nailed Him to the cross, He allowed Him to be beaten, whipped, bruised, and hung there until He died. He sent Him to hell. Why? So that you and I could have power to live our purpose. Life's about not about money. It's not about accumulation. It's about being the person that God created you to be. And if you'll do that, it doesn't make any difference what happens around you. I have a purpose. I have a reason. With my grandchildren, one of the things that I've always done, I always pray with them, pray over them. Every time I see them, I make sure and tell them, God loves you. God has a plan for your life. I tell them they're beautiful. They're wonderful. Of course they are. or prettiest kids that have ever walked the face of the earth. Even my grandson. Okay, I'm sorry, but all of yours are second. All right, okay. There you go. Do you understand that God looks at every single one of you that way? It's not about your performance. It's not about your hair color. It's not about your life. It's not about what you have done or what you haven't done. God loves you. If you understand that, it doesn't make any difference what happens. When I was getting death threats from the Klan for integrating the church for the first time in 135 years in Louisiana, and people were threatening to kill me. Okay. I didn't sit on my front porch armed because I was worried they were going to hurt me. I sat on my front porch armed because of what was inside the house. A wife that I adored, three kids that were mine. And you weren't going to hurt them without taking me out first. Why? Because that's what I'm here for. You say, well, hold up, Carl. You said that seeking first the kingdom of God. Here, listen to me, okay? Why should every girl crave a man that loves God? Why should you, as a female, crave a man that loves God above all things? Because a man that loves God above all things is going to want to make sure he pleases God. You know that God said that, man, if you're married, you're supposed to love her so much you're willing to lay down your life for her every single day. Find a man that loves God and you'll find a man that's willing to die for you. Not a bad deal, is it? Find a man that loves God, he'll never lie to you. Find a man that loves God, he'll never cheat on you. We have got a person who's been visiting our church, and we had staff meeting, and staff was finished, and staff walked out, and I've got about 30 minutes in between. This beautiful woman comes walking in the door. And I went, I got a problem. I said, good to see you. Everybody else will be here in a few minutes. I'm going outside. I got in my truck, drove around to the back of the parking lot. Watched the driveway. When people started coming in, people came in the room, I came back in. I'm out of here. After everything was finished, I said, you know, I need to explain myself. I don't have a problem with you. I think you're a wonderful person, but I hope you understand. But I don't stay in buildings with women by myself. It's not something against you. I like you. I think you're a great person. I'm glad you're here. But my staff had left. It's just you and I in here. And she was very gracious. She understood. She said, "Yeah, I know." People would kind of think things, and everything's fine. We're still friends, but I'm just not going to do it. Why? Because I don't want somebody to go to my wife and say, well, you know, I saw your husband hanging out with a woman, and they were alone in the church. I wonder what they were doing. I'm just not going to do it. Why? Because I'm worried that my wife might think I'm doing something? No. I don't even want my wife to have a question. Girls, that's why you need to make sure that you find a man that loves God. Men, why should you want your kids? Parents, why would you want your kids to find a man to marry a woman that loves God? A woman that loves God, the Bible says, is going to honor her husband. It means that she's going to encourage, she's going to uplift. when it's 98 degrees in August and she's 8 months pregnant and the utility's off and she's sweating up, she's still inside fixing your supper because she knows you're fixing to have to go out to work, and she's never going to complain because she knows that the two of you are in it together. From the very beginning, teach them purpose. Morals, ethics, and faith are learned through hearing and seeing. You see, the truth is that we don't teach them right from wrong by just words. We teach them right from wrong by living correctly in front of them. After Damon, my grandson, was born, there's something I had to do. Two things, really. I needed to get him a University of Tennessee sweatshirt. That's important, okay? I got all my kids a t-shirt, sweatshirt that said University of Tennessee because I never went to the University of Tennessee, but I'm a Tennessee football fan and I wanted to raise them right. Tennessee or LSU, okay? Second thing I did is I called a buddy of mine up and I said, you know what? I saw the other day you've got an 1892 Stevens single shot 22. He said, yeah, I've got one. I said, you just sold it. He said, do you want to know how much you want for it? I said, no, I'm buying it for my grandson. He said, oh, great. Y'all going to go out shooting tomorrow? I said, no, probably about tomorrow, but at some time we're going to go. He said, how old is your grandson? I said, he's born yesterday. No, I didn't take a one-day-old shooting 22s. It's in my closet. And he and his mother are still having, and I are still having diatribes about when it's going to come out, but I'm going to do it just like I did his daddy. We're going to talk. I'm going to explain safety, safety, safety. At some point in time, I'm going to sit him in my lap. I'm going to show him how to put the bullet in. I'm going to show him how to aim. I'm even going to take some spent shells and put it in there and teach him to dry fire so he doesn't flinch when he pulls the trigger. I'm going to teach him how to raise it up, and I'm going to teach him how to aim first. Then after he's learned that, I'm going to get the shotgun that I bought him. I'm going to teach him how to shoot that. And then we're going to go duck hunting, just like I did my son. I've taught all my children how to shoot. They've never killed anybody. They never shot anybody. I taught them how to hunt. We cook what we kill. We actually eat it, okay? Just, I'm not trying to be mean or gross, but I taught them by doing it with them. I taught them how to pray by kneeling at their bedside at night, praying and weeping over them. I taught them how to apologize by sitting them down and saying, listen, I need to apologize to you. I did something wrong. Please forgive me. I taught them how to be a man or woman of their word. The first time my kid looked at me and said, Dad, you lied to me. You said we're going to go fishing today and we didn't go fishing. He said, Dad, we didn't go fishing today. I said, well, son, it's raining outside really bad. He said, well, Dad, you didn't say if it was raining we wouldn't go fishing. You said, promise you, son, Saturday we'll go fishing. And I said, you know what, son? You're right. I was wrong. I made a promise. I didn't keep it. Will you please forgive me? Have you ever looked at an 8-year-old with tears in your eyes and says, son, I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? Then when he looks at you and says, Dad, I forgive you, what do? You say, come on, son. You go out to the closet, pull out the fishing lines, get out there in the rain and go fishing. Why? Because you live as a man or woman of your word. What does the Bible say? Notice what the Bible says in the book of Philippians chapter 4, verse 9. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen from me, put into practice, and the God of grace of peace will be with you. Paul looked at the church at Philippi and said, listen, do what you've seen me do. You see, purpose is caught because purpose is lived out in front of them. Last, and I know I'm already late, but I'm sorry. I'm passionate about my grandkids. Stability of purpose is ingrained through patterns. Is ingrained through patterns. I enjoy sewing, but I've never used a McCall's pattern. I use a person as a pattern. I'll never forget, Shelly and I were first married, and she needed a madrigal costume from the 1600s, and so I bought the material, spread it out on the ground, laid her out on the ground on top of it, and then cut around her. It was one of the most enjoyable evenings we ever had when we first got married. Then I started sewing it up, and I got some pins, and I nipped and tucked, and I'm telling you, every single eighth of an inch was perfectly fitted from her neck to her toes. She was the pattern for that dress. I don't know if you realize this or not, but patterns are kind of, you know, you can get them in 2, 3, 2, 4, 6, or 6, 8, and 12, and then you cut along lines, but it's kind of ambiguous, especially for a younger woman. And I'm going to close with this. First, number one, younger women are not going to really tell you their size correctly. Number two, even though size is a number, everyone is unique in their own way. So if you want it to fit perfectly, the pattern becomes the point of origin. Moms, dads, mothers, grandmothers, great-grandmothers, I want you to listen to me. If you want them to live with purpose for the kingdom of God, make sure the pattern of life you set is correct. Notice what Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you. He said, Timothy, the faith that's real, the faith that's true, the faith that is correct, didn't originate in you, but originated in your mom, and your mother got it from your grandmother. You listen to me, young families, and listen to me well. You set the pattern for your children's life. If you want them to grow up being argumentative and complaining, just argue all the time and complain all the time. If you want them to grow up being non-committal, just don't commit. You set the pattern for their life. But if you want them to survive and thrive in the wilderness, you better make sure that the pattern is a purpose to seek first the kingdom of God. Please stand, let's pray together. Father God, thank you for your love and your grace. You alone are God. Father, I pray that each of us will be committed to helping our children and our grandchildren understand that they were beautifully and wonderfully made by God for a purpose. Father, thank you for your love and your grace. Thank you, Father, for an amazing day to serve you. Father, I pray that it's from this group of people that we raise a generation of Johns that are willing to stand in the wilderness. That they would be like that group of Marines that we watched in the video, this is the days of Elijah. That righteousness would be reborn in the lives of our culture and our community. But Father, I understand it'll never happen without a child or a group of children that stand up with a purpose to seek first the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Our band's going to lead us in a song of worship. I'll be hanging out in the back. If you'd like to pray or talk, I'd love to talk with you.